We're here with the surprisingly British Sean. Sean, it's amazing to meet you.
Well, thank you. People don't know this, but I've been, I'm English. I was actually born in England, and I moved to America in the 80s, and I've been playing Goku with an American accent for 10 years now. It's very similar to Hugh Laurie on House. He's a British man who's playing with an American accent. There's a secret that I'm releasing to all the fans now that I'm actually, my mom and dad, they live in South England, near Seaford, and I've been English this whole time. It's a big secret, and I'm probably not fooling anyone because I'm not British. But I just wanted to try it, see if it worked. But no, I'm American. I don't know. That'd be funny. But
we love you nonetheless, though.
Thank you.
I mean, we're here at the London Film and Comic Con. Have you been enjoying meeting fans today?
Yes, I've been to England once before, but I didn't get to really see any of it. So I'm actually staying, and my girl and I are going to run down to Brighton for the weekend, or for the beginning of the week, and check the coast out and spend a day in London running around. So I never really got to see. I did Milton Keynes a few years ago and didn't really see much. So I'm really excited to be here.
There's not much to see in Milton Keynes when Showmatters isn't on, to be honest.
Told me. They said there's nothing to see in Milton Keynes. I did run around London one day, but I didn't even get to see like the Big Ben or any the Thames or anything. I didn't get to see anything, you know, Parliament or anything really British, you know.
Wherever you go, you're never going to see anything more interesting and surprising than anime fans. Speaking of which, having had quite a bit of experience meeting them, are there any particularly memorable encounters you could tell us?
Why, yes. Yes, there is. But it's a very long story, and I don't know if you have the time for it. But it wasn't really, I don't know that it was a fan per se, but when I was recording Dragon Ball Z Kai, the housekeeping staff left a kazoo in my pants. And then when I got home, I found a tape recorder in my bag that said in Spanish, "The kazoo is here, the kazoo is everywhere, I'm sorry," and then they played a few notes on the kazoo. Actually, the notes were played first. That's the weirdest experience I've had, and I left a note for them in Spanish asking them why they did it, but I forgot to leave an email address so they could explain to me why they would put a kazoo in my pants when I was not there.
If you're watching this, Mystery Kazoo Leavers, please comment and let us know why you inserted a kazoo into this man's trousers.
It was very strange. It was a very, it was a surreal experience that I rather enjoyed because it was kind of, I felt like House. I was like trying to figure this mystery out, you know.
It's probably lupus.
Yeah, it's probably lupus. It's not lupus. Yesterday I was given marshmallow fluff, which I thought was kind of sweet and strange. Which is funny because it says the great American treat, and I've never had it before. I didn't even heard of it before. So I'm like, I'm trying to think of anything. I had a guy years ago make a Sean Schimmel action figure out of another doll, and he was a little too friendly. That was kind of creepy. Like, the doll seemed like it had some kind of extra special meaning for him, if you know what I mean. I remember that from 8 or 9 years ago. But I feel, honestly, I hate to say it because, I mean, to me, Britain rocks. The British fans are more polite and tamer than, I would say, fans in America or even Australia, for that matter. The American fans are the wildest ones, I think. And the British ones are very, they're very creative, but still very polite and very not, you know. The American ones are just more obnoxious, honestly. And I love them, but I'm American, so I can say that. So, I mean, I'm obnoxious to some degree. So, yeah, that's... I can't think of a really weird experience here at the convention other than the marshmallow, which really wasn't that weird, but...
Yeah, I think it counts, it counts.
Sure,
the kazoo story was fantastic. Now, when fans do come up and they're not handing you kazoos or marshmallow fluff, what's the most common question you get asked by fans?
Well, I get asked questions like, how did I start, et cetera, and what's my favorite character to play, or what my favorite moment is, or my favorite line. But honestly, for me, and I get fan mail like this sometimes, for me, it's when the kid whispers in my ear, "Hey man, thanks a lot, you got me through some really rough times." Or I get an email that from a woman whose son has cerebral palsy, and that's the only thing that distracts him from all the pain that he's going through, is to sit there and watch Dragon Ball Z over and over. Those are the most meaningful stories for me. Not to say that the kid who just likes to rock out isn't, you know, have meaning, but the ones that really get me are the ones that I know that what I'm doing is helping somebody through a rough time, you know? Because there are things like that for me as an artist, I mean, I'm not, you know, we all feed off each other, and there's a lot of musical bands that are that way for me when I was going through puberty, and different TV shows that were that way for me when I was depressed. So, and I can say that I went through some bum out times when I was recording Dragon Ball Z, and playing the character of Goku got me through some rough times. So, those are the most meaningful stories for me. Yeah, definitely.
You mentioned Goku and Dragon Ball Z quite a bit there. I mean, clearly it's a show that's meant an awful lot to some people.
Oh, yeah.
What do you think it is about that series that's just distinguished it from so many other anime in similar genres?
Well, here's the deal, and I've spent a lot of time researching this and reading about it, and it was a friend of mine named Wendy Pinney who kind of got me studying this. She created ElfQuest, and she told me that Goku was the legend of the Monkey King and the Great Journey West. And so I started reading about that. And the reason I think it stands the test of time, it's just like Greek tragedies. It's tantamount to Greek tragedies for Asian culture. So we have the Greek tragedies and those stories and Shakespearean plays, when Shakespeare is fantastic in his own right, but you know, he takes the Greek tragedy of Romeo and Juliet. The story itself stands the test of time because these are the classics that are about man's struggles, which are broken down if you study literature, you know, man versus man, man versus society, man versus, you know, the elements or whatever. Because it is a classic ancient story and has been around for hundreds, maybe thousands of years, I don't know, and it's clothed in science fiction and superpowers, underneath that clothing, when you mix it with that, is what makes it so epic. And Akira Toriyama was brilliant enough to realize that and craft it into this legendary story. And that's why Shakespeare stands the test of time, I think, other than the brilliant writing. And the Greek tragedies stand the test of time, and Plato and Homer, and, you know, it's similar to that in its origins. And I think that's why it has so much power to... I think that's why Dragon Ball Z will never die. You have other shows that come and go, and even when you're studying writing, they want you to draw on these patterns and say, these are the stories that... You know, they say there's no new songs, and that, or some people say the Beatles wrote all the possible good melodies there is to write in a pop song or whatever. Song structures are the same way musically. So, and Mozart locked into a lot of those. So it's all epic because of what I'm talking about, in my opinion. So that's the medium answer.
There's so many different elements to Dragon Ball, like you said there, and you know, there's all these serious undertones and the messages and the kind of philosophy behind it.
Sure.
Then on top of that, you've got superpowers, you've got action, you've got adventure.
And there's Buddhist ideas, a lot of Buddhist ideas in there. I mean, all the energy is all chi, and it's and they call it ki in Japanese, you know. So anyway, you were saying, sorry.
Well, I was going to say, I mean, with all of that going on, with all of that going into a character, how easy is it to get inside a character's head?
Well, here's the interesting thing about Goku. My producer told me that a very wise Asian man said, and I think he was referring to Goku, referring to Akira Toriyama when he said this, when he was trying to teach me, you know, about the character. He said, Goku is pure of heart. And then I studied the character more, and I asked a Japanese guy who was working on a video game with him. I said, what does the name mean? And he said, loosely translated, it means master of knowing nothing. And in Zen Buddhism, they transmit enlightenment through a touch. And so when he does the instant transmission, I feel like that's symbolic of giving enlightenment to himself. So master of knowing nothing means that Goku is the embodiment in his spirit of the beginner's mind and not being covered up by the accoutrements and trappings of life. And in order to play him that way, I have to forget about all my problems and just get very happy and very clear. Like, I mean, when I see the Dalai Lama speak, he's so happy and clear. It reminds me very much of Goku. Very happy, very clear, not weighed down by the trappings of life. And so that's kind of, and I'm a Zen Buddhist myself, so I don't think I've attained anywhere near that kind of, I have all kinds of, and that's the reason I'm a Buddhist, but I've drawn on Zen Buddhism for my inspiration to play Goku. I've drawn on the legend of the Monkey King for my inspiration to play it. And when I play it, it's not me, it's something else that I'm doing. And I feel weird taking credit for it sometimes, because really it's Masuka Nozawa originally, you know. So that's kind of the philosophical answer as to how I feel about playing Goku. It's very special and separate from everything else I do. Very different. It's its own entity, separate from all the other voices I've done. And it always will be. It always will be.
Talking about all of those other voices, obviously fans are going to have their favorites. You lent your voice to so many different shows. Are there any, apart from Dragon Ball Z, that stand out for you, any that you're especially proud of performance-wise or just in terms of the series you've been involved with?
Well, there's some prelay stuff I did. I really enjoyed playing Gonard and Kappa Mikey, which is kind of a parody of Goku. I enjoyed Tetsugyu and Giant Robo. I like playing Ansakamaru, which is basically, since we're here in England, it's basically Asian Benny Hill. I mean, he's a yellow ball, he's a pervert, and he's running around, and it's pervy humor, but it's not too gross, you know, it's not like hentai.
Ichi.
Yeah, it's like, you know, tongue-in-cheek. Yeah. I enjoyed playing that. I enjoyed playing Dr. Crowler in Yu-Gi-Oh! GX and Paradox in the Yu-Gi-Oh! Movie and Lucario. Some of these that are here are actually some of my favorites. And Ryo and Shaman King was really fun. Yeah, so there's a few that I really enjoyed. I'm trying to think if there's any others. No, that's about it. I mean, there's probably others that I can't think of right now, but... Oh, and there's some characters in Thumb Wrestling Federation, which is a thumb wrestling show that I really enjoyed playing, so...
Obviously, when fans meet voice actors, they love to ask them to say certain lines or do certain voices. What are the most common requests that you get?
I get a lot of requests to do the Kamehameha, which I usually don't do when I'm signing because it's just way too loud. And I try to do it at panels. Today, voice is practically gone, so it's not happening. Over 9,000. It's over 9,000! You know, I get asked to do that a lot. You know, among some other things. Sometimes they ask, some guy earlier today asked me to just curse as Goku. So I'm like, all right. Because he curses in the series. Not in the original, but in Kai he does. It's not a big no-no for Goku to curse. He's not, like, it's not a big deal, so.
What kind of cuss words is Goku rocking out?
In the series, I said shit and damn it, and the guy wanted me to say assholes, so. I don't know, Goku's never said asshole, so.
How would he say?
Asshole! You guys are assholes and better leave this planet right now, you know? Because you guys are a bunch of assholes, whatever that means. He probably doesn't know what it means, you know, I don't know.
I'm having a flashback to so many other interviews. I guess one question before we let you go that young fans are obviously going to want to know. If they want to follow in your footsteps, what advice would you give?
Not to do it, first of all. Voiceover world is extraordinarily difficult. If you really want to do it, there's several paths you can take. The standard path is to get involved in acting, get involved with a voiceover coach. I did not take that path. I did voices at home all the time, practiced all the time because it was fun. Then I auditioned for a show, Dragon Ball Z, got the lead, and then took it from there. Moved to a town where there is lots of voiceover. Try to get work that is in union or residuals based because the non-union stuff does not pay very well. But if you love it, it's worth it. It's hard. I say don't do it, but I got to say that I'm sending a mixed message here because I sacrificed a lot to do it, and it's been worth it. I lay in bed at night, and I'm like, this is the greatest job in the world. I can't see a doctor when I need to, but it's the greatest job in the world. So I knew that going into it, and I'm okay with that for now. But and you got to do it because you love it and because you're good at it, and you love the craft of doing it, not just because you like watching cartoons, although that can be a start, you know what I mean? So I guess that's all I wanted to say. I mean, I could talk about it for a while, but...
Very final question. What are we going to hear you in coming up? What have you got on the go?
Right now I'm working on Yu-Gi-Oh! Zexal. I play Bronk in Orbital 9 in that. I just finished a video game, based on a major motion picture that's coming out this summer that I absolutely can't talk about. But I am playing the lead character of an iconic action hero. And I'm very, very excited about that. I'm working on some Indian animation. I just finished the sequel to Shit My Dad Says. Called I Suck at Girls, which is an audiobook that's very popular. I'm trying to think of other animation. I just did some more Pokemon episodes. But things are a little bit slow in the industry right now, so I'm always on the lookout and trying to do new things and, you know, see what's on the horizon. I'm planning a move to LA soon to do some more work out there, hopefully. So right now all my work's in New York for the most part. So we'll see what happens.